You might not realize it, but mathematics can unlock incredible power. You can use it to make your dreams become reality. Mathematics is a powerful tool for exploring life on Earth and for discovering our place in the universe. Mathematics is changing the way we play our games, the way we think about ourselves. It's the fuel that's driving the information age. This is mathematics like you've never seen it before.
Major funding for this program comes from the National Science Foundation, America's investment in the future. And the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation to increase understanding of the application of mathematics in everyday life. Additional funding provided by the McDonnell Douglas Foundation and the Alcoa Foundation, with exclusive corporate support from Texas Instruments.
Texas Instruments is proud to partner with the education community to create the calculators that help children do extraordinary things. Because the more our children can get out of math and science, the more they'll get out of life.
Do you see a pattern? It's a bit complicated. But if you look at it the right way, it's easy to see. This is a mathematical shape created by equations. And one of the strange things about it is it's helping us to understand how trees and flowers grow. These shapes are mathematical knots. And they're also telling us something about life on Earth. Their tangles and twists have been classified and analyzed. And to the surprise of many, knots are leading to clues in the battle against disease. More and more, people are turning to mathematics to see and to study nature. To some biologists, there's life in the numbers. As mathematical equations unfold, nature is revealing its secrets.
We interrupt this program for an important announcement. The giant locusts have reached the Chicago South Side and nearby suburbs.
Repeat.
The giant locusts have reached the Chicago South Side and nearby suburbs.
Hold your fire, men! Fire!
I love these old movies, these old science fiction movies. Partly because I'm a biologist.
If those grasshoppers don't end up eating the Sirius Tower.
Yeah.
Michael LaBarbera is a unique biologist. To him, giants and monsters are a favorite subject.
One aspect of what makes, I think, a really good scientist is keeping the curiosity alive and uncensored into your adult life. Some of us don't censor it enough and watch horror movies and try to analyze the monsters.
When LaBarbera studies monsters, one thing he considers is their size. He's curious to explore what happens when creatures become gigantic. For example, if you take a gorilla and blow it up to the size of King Kong, the barber calculates that its bones would be enlarged a few hundred times. But its weight would increase more than 14,000 times. Kong, in other words, would have a gigantic weight problem. His excess fat would crush his bones, even if he were standing still. Giant grasshoppers would have a similar problem.
In the beginning of the end with the giant grasshoppers, as those grasshoppers walk down the street, you ought to see the legs visibly bowing if they don't exactly buckle because of the sheer size of their body. In this movie, them with the giant ants, the same would have been true. It's clear that size is a very basic variable in biological systems.
LaBarber traces his ideas about monsters back 350 years ago to the Italian astronomer Galileo. To Galileo, giants were strictly fantasy. To him, nature was not governed by magic, but by logic. Galileo illustrated that when you increase the size of an animal, its bones would grow large, but its weight increases disproportionately. Galileo realized that this simple mathematical relationship between size and weight is not only true for animals, but in fact, for all things.
Take the sugar cube or any other shape, and you increase it in size, making it larger and larger, but keeping shape constant. What happens is that areas increase, of course, as you increase in size, but volume increases at a faster rate than area does.
To see how this works, imagine a sugar cube that is three times bigger than a standard cube. The cube will be three times wider, three times deeper, and three times taller. The area has increased from one face per side to nine faces per side. Area increased nine times. But the volume has increased from one to 27 cubes. Volume or weight has increased 27 times. This simple relationship can tell us a lot more about plants and animals, and even ourselves. If a human becomes gigantic, the size of his bones will grow. But their weight increases faster, and they can find it difficult to move. Each species is a unique size, and mathematics tells us why an ant and a gorilla can't transform into giant monsters. To be a giant, creatures need to be able to carry a tremendous and crushing weight. Dinosaurs were built to be big. Some had massive bones bigger than tree trunks to support their weight. All creatures, large and small, do share one surprising thing in common. As we move, we all come uncomfortably close to breaking our bones. And that's true of most animals.
If you actually look at animals doing their normal behaviors, what you find is an interesting regularity. Mammalian locomotor systems, the bones, the muscles, are put together in such a way as to always keep the maximum stresses that are exerted on the bone about a quarter to a third of the breaking stress of the bone. In other words, what they're doing in their normal behaviors is loading their bones to stresses that are approximately 25 to 30% the stresses at which those bones will break. And this applies across the board, mammals as small as chipmunks to as large as elephants. This speaks to me of a real elegance of design. The tightness of the design is much tighter than an engineer would typically design a building or a structure, with very few exceptions. Engineering structures are never built to exert stresses so close to the failure stresses as we see used routinely in mammals.
To keep stress from breaking our bones, all creatures do something incredibly simple. We shift our posture and change the way we move.
What you see in horse, for example, the horse would start out at low speeds using a walk, and as it moves faster, the stresses do indeed increase, but they increase up to this 25 to 30% of braking strength, and then the horse changes the way it moves. It moves from a walk to a trot. And when it moves from the walk to the trot, changing the way it puts its legs down and picks them up, the stresses drop. As it moves faster in a trot, the stresses increase yet again till we hit this magic 25 to 30%. And again, it changes its gait. It moves into a canter. Stresses drop again. As it moves faster in the canter, the stresses build up again until we have another gait change into a gallop.
Mathematics reveals that as we move, stress increases on our bones. And to relieve the stress, we change our posture. The way we hold our body.
Down, turn, that's it. Good, let's go.
This simple idea about motion and posture is also helping LaBarbara understand how dinosaurs must have moved.
One of the more interesting uses of this is to look at an animal the size of a tyrannosaur. Rather than being bird-like in the way they move, they were much more like mammals, with the legs held under the body and straight during locomotion. Mathematics is changing the way we understand these animals as having held their bodies, and thus changing the way we think about how they hunted, how they lived. The more you know, the deeper you'll see, the more you will be able to extract this underlying structure and beauty.
Come in all sizes and shapes. They also display a variety of colorful and beautiful patterns. Mathematician James Murray is fascinated by patterns. His interests begin with a bedtime story, a fable he read to his daughter more than 30 years ago.
"I'll take spots then," said the leopard. "But don't make them ever too vulgar big. I wouldn't look like giraffe, not forever so." "I'll make them with the tips of my fingers," said the Ethiopian. "There's plenty of black left in my skin still. Stand over." Then the Ethiopian put his five fingers close together and pressed them all over the leopard. And wherever the five fingers touched, they left five little black marks, all close together. "You can see them on any leopard's skin you like, best beloved. Sometimes the fingers slipped and the marks got a little blurred. But if you look closely at any leopard now, you will see that there are always five spots, or five fat black little fingertips." "Now you are a beauty," said the Ethiopian. "Think of that and purr."
Murray's daughter loved the fable about the leopard, but as she grew older, she wanted to know the real reason behind the leopard's spots.
She said, "But how do they really get their spots?" And so I thought, well, I'd no idea, really. I mean, I quite liked Kipling's idea, but of course it's fairly unscientific. And so I said that I would ask some of my colleagues in the university. I was in Oxford at the time, and it became very clear that no one knew how coat patterns were formed. So it was with that in mind that I started to try and come up with ideas of how they might happen.
Animals have beautiful patterns. Detail, exquisite. But nobody knows how they're formed.
When one looks at the coat patterns on a leopard, I think of how they were formed. And it's certainly not like painting by numbers. There must be some process which creates the coat pattern.
Murray found his first clue to the leopard spots in some very tiny patterns. This moving pattern is about the size of a nickel. It's created by combining chemicals. As the chemicals react, they spread out and form a design. As you change the amount of chemicals, the pattern changes. Change another variable, and you get another pattern. Patterns like this gave Murray an idea about how the leopard got its spots.
The idea is a very simple one. At some stage during the development of the leopard, the embryo, there will be a genetically controlled switch which produces this chemical pattern, which are like the spots on a leopard. And this chemical pattern really consists of regions of high concentration of a chemical and low concentrations of a chemical. And cells underneath the skin, which find themselves in regions of high concentration of the chemical, will produce the color. And the cells that find themselves in the regions of low concentration of this chemical don't produce it. So the question that one asks about coat patterns is, how do you produce this chemical pattern that is the pattern that the cells are responding to?
Using just paper and pencil, Murray built something very powerful called the mathematical model. The model is built with equations, and the equations describe real things like chemical reactions. In his work, Murray noticed something amazing. When his chemicals reacted in a long, thin cylinder, like a leopard's tail, he got a pattern that looked like the leopard's. When he changes the shape of the tail, the pattern also changes. Now there are more spots, and it looks like the cheetah's. When he changes the shape again, the tail becomes striped. Like the Jeanette's. Murray next focused on embryos. And by changing their size and shape, he created the stripes of zebra and the spots of giraffe and many other coat patterns. Using mathematics, Murray made an amazing discovery. Coat patterns may be determined by an animal's size and shape.
One of the really exciting things about this was that one was able to produce all the coat patterns that I had seen up to that time with one single mechanism and just varying size and shape. And this, the idea that a single mechanism could produce all the coat patterns observed in the mammalian kingdom seemed to me a very efficient process of producing coat patterns.
James Murray has drafted his version of a classical bedtime story, and he's written it in the language of mathematics.
Mathematics, it's not the mystery, I think, that people think it is. It's just a way of speaking. It's a language.
Viruses are among the oldest organisms on the Earth. And some are extremely deadly. Viruses are very elusive. And they leave few clues to how they kill. But there's a new powerful weapon in the fight against viruses. Mathematics.
Okay, so my
Sylvia Spangler and DeWitt Sumners are a unique
nice
team.
Trim.
Pound and a half.
Pound and a half.
Yeah. Pound and a half of mediums.
She's a biologist.
All right, what's the list?
We have rosemary.
He's a mathematician.
I've got bay leaves.
Together, they're detectives working to gather clues about viruses.
Well, you dip your bread in the sauce.
Yes. Viruses have secrets, and we like to know what they are. And eating a meal gets the creative juices flowing.
It's on, just to be on the safe side.
Yes. Here's the mathematics and molecular biology.
Viruses have been developed over the centuries to take advantage of other living systems. We have viruses that take advantage of plants, we have viruses that take advantage of bacteria, and we have viruses that take advantage of animals, whether the animals are horses or pigs or monkeys or humans. And most of what a virus does, it does the same in almost every system.
This virus is one of the most studied of all viruses. After it lands on the cell, it injects itself through the cell wall. Once inside, the virus creates an enzyme. Seen here is a cloud. This enzyme inserts the virus into the cell's DNA. Now the virus controls the cell, and it commands the cell to replicate the virus until the cell explodes, and the virus spreads.
The reason that we're really interested in how viruses act is because deep at the heart of how something happens is the way to control how something happens. And our hope is that in the long run, we'll actually be able to stop them.
Spengler is interested in the most critical phase of the virus's attack. She'd like to see how the enzyme inserts the virus. The only problem is the process is too small to see.
If you can actually understand how this insertion step is done, and if you can actually identify the enzyme that does it for each particular virus, it gives you a target. It gives you a way of stopping the virus.
To begin to see the process, Spengler takes an enzyme from a bacterial virus called Int, and she places it in a test tube. In the test tube, the enzyme is cutting and manipulating long strings of DNA. When the reaction is complete, the enzyme has tied the DNA into a knot.
Yeah, but it's still got a nice, got a nice pattern. There it is. That's a good guy.
Knots are Sumner's area of expertise. He is a specialist in a branch of mathematics called knot theory. To him, knots are like fingerprints. And these knots are a distinct mark of the Int virus.
Probably seven.
If he can figure out how the knots are tied, he can see how the virus attacks.
Six.
Seven or nine.
Nine.
Crossing
maybe
nine.
One, two, three, four,
so that's
five,
a nice
six,
knot.
Seven,
it just happens
eight.
To have another molecule.
I probably could say nine.
You know the kind of DNA you're inserting into these experiments. The enzyme takes it in the back room, does something to it, and out the door comes an interesting topological form, like a knot or a spectrum of knots. And then the problem is to figure out what happened back there where you can't see it.
The first step in the process is to identify the knots.
Under, over, oops, over, under.
Knot theorists have been identifying knots for more than 100 years. And over that time, they have classified more than 12,000. One way they distinguish knots is by counting crossover points. For example, this knot crosses itself 6 times. Another way to identify knots is by manipulating them. Knots can be rotated, twisted, and stretched. Until recently, knot theory hasn't had any application in the real world. Today, however, knots are popping out of the textbooks and turning up in some interesting places.
The excitement about seeing knotted DNA is that you're recognizing old friends, these knots, the ones you've seen in textbooks. Here they are turning up in real life. They've become in the flesh. So this is terrific.
One of the knots the Ent virus has tied crosses itself 3 times. Summoners wants to figure out how this knot was created. In his work, Summoners relies on drawings, rubber tubes, and photographs as he tries to untangle the viral knot. He knows that the DNA starts out coiled. He's beginning to see how the enzyme bends the coil, bringing 2 points close together. Next, the enzyme cuts the DNA, and it forces the 2 strands to change position. It's at this critical point that the virus is inserted. If they can stop this step, they can stop the virus. Enzyme by enzyme, knot by knot, Summoners and Spangler are beginning to see how viruses work. Ironically, knot theory, which was never meant to be applied to real life, may someday help stop disease.
It's a constant battle to fight with viruses, and any tools we can have in this battle are good ones. So it's know thy enemy in that sense. Anything and everything you know about them can and will be used against them.
For hundreds of years, mathematics and biology have been separate disciplines. To Spangler and Summoners, the future looks quite different.
Lots more dinners, lots more walks, lots more talking.
Lots more talking.
Lots more playing with ideas.
That's mathematicians and biologists.
One of mathematics' greatest powers is its ability to describe things. Circles, triangles, rectangles. These geometric shapes can be used to describe things we make with remarkable precision. Thank you.
But when it comes to Mother Nature, she seems to be coloring outside the lines. What shape is a flower? What are its characteristics?
When I am looking at plants, what I find beautiful is their shape and form. But there is also another layer of beauty. We could say that it is a little bit hidden beauty. It is not what we see at first sight when we look at a plant. It is the beauty of the understanding of the mechanisms which bring this form about.
Przemysław Przeszkiewicz, or Dr. P for short, studies plant growth. And in his work, he turns to a new geometry that begins to describe nature's forms. This new geometry is based on something called fractals. Fractals are unusual shapes that mathematicians began creating at the turn of the century. They are unruly and intricate, and they are different than traditional geometry. To create a classical fractal, take a triangle and add a triangle to each side. Repeat the rule forever, and the cock snowflake is formed. In the 1960s, mathematician Benoit Mandelbrot pointed out that these old forms have several striking characteristics. First, very intricate shapes can be created by repeating simple rules. And second, small parts of the shape look like big parts. Mandelbrot named forms like these fractals, and he created a famous fractal of his own. Nature is filled with forms that are fractal-like. They are not true mathematical fractals, but they do have some things in common. For example, consider a tree. Small branches look like big branches, which look similar to the entire tree. The fractal characteristic, where small parts look like big parts, is called self-similarity.
There was a period in my life when the idea that self-similarity is so widely present in nature, and in particular in plants, that I was looking for it almost everywhere.
To Dr. P, it seems like nature relies on fractal geometry. And to capture the fractal nature of plants, he turns to a mathematical tool called an L system. An L system is simply a set of repeatable rules that can be used to create structures, like the branches of a tree. For example, an L system might state that if we start with the top of a branch, this portion will always form two new branches and three new tops. If we repeat this simple rule, a complex branching structure is formed. To model a lilac on a computer, Dr. P first creates a simple L system.
Next, he takes careful measurements of the branching structure. With this information, Dr. P refines his L system to closer reflect reality. Once the branching structure is complete, he adds the final touch by creating self-similar flower blossoms.
It is very exciting to see that structures which we used to think of as very complex turn out to be very simple in principle. A plant is repeating the same thing over and over again. But since it is doing it in so many places, the plant winds up with a structure which looks very complex to us. But it is just intricate.
Mathematical equations are producing a striking new view of the natural world. And this new view is suggesting a rather provocative idea. Much of the complexity we see in the natural world may be the result of some very simple rules.
Creativity is the essence of mathematics. Mathematics is not playing with numbers and doing accounting. Mathematics is dealing with ideas in a creative yet very precise way.
Rainforest for 20 years. It's so beautiful. The rainforest is full of life. Everywhere you turn, there's some creature, plant, or animal, and so many different kinds, you'll never see them all. It's really a vast unknown.
In 1989, Tom Ray moved from the tropics to begin his spectacular experiment. What he intended to do was create a virtual rainforest. One that he had built from scratch using mathematics. Ray built his artificial world inside a computer. He imagined that the landscape would be filled with creatures he called digital organisms.
like real living things, digital organisms, could actually reproduce offspring. To build his creatures, Ray relied on a powerful mathematical tool called an algorithm. An algorithm is like a recipe. It's a set of instructions. Inside a special computer, Ray's creatures, seen here in green, would have to follow an algorithm in order to reproduce. First, the creature would have to measure its size. Second, it would have to find space in the computer exactly that size. Only then would it be able to reproduce. Some offspring, however, would be different than their parents. Occasionally, there would be mutations, signified here by a lightning bolt. When they occur, an organism miscalculates its size and makes a smaller version of itself. These smaller versions are like new species of life. In a rainforest, it's believed that new species are formed in a similar way. When parents reproduce, their offspring are not exact replicas. There are slight mutations that make each individual different. Over time, it is believed that changes can build up that are so dramatic that a new species is created. This theory is called evolution.
One way that I like to think about evolution is to think of evolution as an artist. To me, it's the best there is. The artistic creations of evolution are incredibly beautiful and complex. Imagine a hummingbird pollinating a flower, or a cheetah running down its prey, or the human body. Those are fantastically beautiful things.
Ray believes that if evolution can create rich diversity in the real world, it can also create diversity inside his computer.
So I sort of play the role of setting up the studio for evolution to create its art in.
For months, Ray designed a single computer organism. He called it the ancestor. If his experiment worked, he'd actually see the ancestor evolve into new species. Late one night, Ray loads the ancestor, seen here as a red line, into his computer. With the click of a button, the ancestor comes to life, and to Ray's surprise, it begins to reproduce rapidly. New species are born quickly, seen as different colors. Inside the computer, life flourishes. Death strikes the old and the weak, making room for future generations.
That night, the first time that it ran, I got a pretty rich evolution, which surprised me and surprised everybody. I got or hundreds of mutant versions of the original program that survived. In a few hours, the original ancestor evolved into a tree of digital life, a whole array of different species that are all connected, just like organic life on Earth.
With every second, the digital life is getting more complex. It's becoming more advanced. And to raise surprise, creatures are behaving like the creatures he saw in the rainforest.
What I saw that I knew from organic life was that we had interactions between the different species, like cooperation and cheating and lying and stealing.
Given the right conditions, Ray believes his creatures will continue to evolve. And it is possible, according to evolutionary theory. After all, life on Earth may have started as simple bacteria and algae.
If all we know about digital organisms are the equivalent of algae and protozoa, I don't think we can really fully envision the possibilities that are out there. It could be that evolution can reach a comparable level of complexity in the digital medium, in which case it would be truly fantastic. The excitement is about the potential. We're venturing into the unknown.
A mathematical recipe executed in the computer may be starting a new age of invention and discovery. Using mathematics, a computer screen may turn out to be a window into another world. For centuries, life on Earth has defied mathematical description. Mathematics' rigid rules could not capture the essence of life, its detail and complexity. But things are beginning to change.
Math has to become a bigger part of biology. We're just beginning to understand how animals and plants are designed.
Some of nature's most spectacular creations have been modeled using mathematical equations. Simple rules, it turns out, can lead to dramatic complexity. Mathematics is giving us a new way to see the invisible, revealing secrets that can improve our lives.
It's remarkable to discover how many connections mathematics makes, how many light bulbs it suddenly turns on in your head.
Exploring nature with mathematics is a new frontier. Everywhere we look, there are questions to be answered, mysteries to be solved.
It really is a very exciting time to be a mathematician who works in biology. And I do find it quite difficult not to look at a fern or the bark of a tree and wonder how it was formed. It just seems to me that there are so many questions that one would like to know the answers to.
To learn more about the Life by the Numbers series, visit PBS Online at the internet address on your screen. Exclusive corporate support for this program comes from Texas Instruments.
Texas Instruments is proud to partner with the education community to create the calculators that help children do extraordinary things. Because the more our children can get out of math and science, the more they'll get out of life.
With major funding from the National Science Foundation, America's investment in the future. And the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, to increase understanding of the application of mathematics in everyday life. Additional funding provided by the McDonnell Douglas Foundation and the Alcoa Foundation. To order a video of this program, other programs in the Life by the Numbers series, or the companion book, please call 1-800-274-1307 or write to the address on your screen.
This is PBS.